Dr. Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishant ji has also consented to address us via webinar. So we have been very tied up in trying to sort that out. It's a huge, what should I say? It's a huge operation when any minister joins, even via webinar. They want so many details, इतनी उनकी पूरी एक टीम होती है तो सिर्फ टॉकिंग पॉइंट्स नहीं पूरी स्पीच यहाँ से जाती है फिर वो यूज नहीं करेंगे वो तो अपना करेंगे बट पूरी हिस्ट्री बताओ ये करो ऑल डे वी आर डूइंग ओनली दिस बट आई होप इट कम्स ऑफ वेल प्लीज कम ऑल ऑफ यू मैं आपको पर्सनली इन्वाइट कर रहा हूँ इसलिए मैंने सोचा ऐसे में शुरुआत करता हूँ सो प्लीज डू कम बिकॉज आर फेलोज आर एक्सट्रीमली इम्पोर्टेंट in the institute because without fellows there's no institute it's only a building it's only a tourist attraction so Saturday 10:15 we'll have tea and then at 11 o'clock with social distance we'll be in the whole theater so on each side we'll have only three people you know so six people to a row and the remaining people will be outside So this is the plan. So please come and spread the word also because we're going to create a spillover room in case that place fills up. There'll be the same. If people want to listen to the minister, वहाँ भी हम वो उसकी योजना कर रहे हैं. So I'm going to leave after starting this and maybe join from upstairs. But when I just wanted to say that when the first presentation of Mr. Subramanian was made. I made some points and I started reading his abstract for today and the same points came to my head. So I'm going to start with that. But before that, you see, why is the writing of history so contentious? We should ask that. And we are in the middle of, in fact, a ferment when it comes to the way our past is being conceptualized and presented, disseminated, narrated. And that is because it is present interests which inform our reconstruction of the past. So there is no such thing as a, what should I say, untainted, I use that word deliberately in the Kantian sense, you know, that there is no such pure, what should I say, epistemology through which we can get the true picture of the past, because the past is mediated. It's never presented as it was, despite historians taking various measures in order not to, you know, have interference by looking at, you know, the documentation, because, you know, historiography is not like writing fiction. Right, it has certain protocols. It has certain, what should I say, processes of validation without which it is not accepted as history. And yet, we know more and more that the two, history and fiction, are very similar. Frankly, there's been a lot of research to show that both are informed by plots, protagonists, antagonists, themes, climaxes, or denouements, if you want to use that phrase, the French phrase, mise-en-scène, atmosphere, style. So the writing of history and the writing of fiction actually share several tropes, you know, share several conventions, share several modes of narration. And therefore, the writing of history is, or the rewriting of history, the reconsideration of the past, is impregnated with ideological and other interests. Okay, so this is an opening statement I wanted to make. I think Mr. Subramanian's work is not free of those issues that inform all the writing of history. So when I was listening to him initially, when we were interviewing him, I was very fascinated by his topic. And as I said last time, I want to start with that. There are four moments to consider, okay? The moment of Periyar Puran by Sekkilar, going back to around the 12th century. Correct me if I'm wrong. And Nandanar, who is he? He may be a mythic figure. We don't have any historic evidence of a person such as Nandanar. as far as I know. But we receive him through the Periyar Puran, which is an incredible book. I mean, I have read it in translation. I have a special fascination for this book for reasons I mentioned last time, which I won't repeat. Anyhow, so there is the Nandanar, well, you can say five moments, the real Nandanar, whoever he was, then Nandanar as we see him through the Periyar Puran. Then you come to the topic, several centuries elapse, we come to the 19th century, and we come to the topic, which is this gentleman, Bharati, whose full name is Gopal Krishna. I've got it here in his abstract, Gopal Krishna Bharati, who wrote an opera on Nandanar. So we skip centuries. So the third moment is Gopal Krishna Bharati's reconstruction or depiction or representation or presentation. I think Mr. Subramanian keeps using that word presentation in various ways, which I like, because you see, represent and present have deep meanings, you see. And because you present and then you represent, you see. So implicit in that word, represent, is this great word ideology, okay? And what is ideology? Marx in the German ideology said it's a kind of false consciousness, okay? But I think in literary studies and in recent other hermeneutical studies, ideology is simply seen as the gap between the overt, what should I say, meanings of the text and its covert meanings. The tension that is set up between the two is a way to problematize representation, is a way to problematize the author's own subject position. Okay, so a lot of hermeneutics is about trying to look at a text in terms of its overt and covert meanings, you know. So there's the text, there's the subtext, there's the context, there's the paratext, etc. Okay? I think Mr. Subramanian's work addresses all these. You know, the context of Bharati, the subtext, his own subject position as a Brahmin who wants to rehabilitate Nandanar, you know, the paratext, everything that surrounds the text, you know, that is around the text. Now, so that's the original Nandanar, whoever he was, Sekular's Nandanar, Bharati's Nandanar, you have three texts and three moments. And then, of course, you have what Mr. Subramanian is trying to do, which is to read Bharati in that complex manner. And he also says, oh, I have underlined something he said, let me see if I can find it. He also says, Dr. Ambedkar succinctly remarked during a debate, I'm not a part of the whole, I am a part apart. Dalits have been the part that was essential for the whole to function, but kept distinct from the whole. And then he also says, this gives us multiple viewpoints and constructions of Dalithood. As a consequence, we have shifting and fleeting images dialoguing and contending with one another. This may be a problematic thought experiment, but it helps in illumining some of the dark corners of our own minds, if nothing else, right? So, you know, the text, what I'm trying to say, finally I take up the pariah question implicit in Bharati's thinking and his Brahminic solution to it. A solution incidentally shared by both the Christian missionaries and the Sufis, which left the Dalits themselves rather cold. It's a very interesting point that is implicit in his project. Again, it's a problem of who speaks, you know. Can the subaltern speak? If not, who speaks on behalf of the subaltern? And my question, where I'm going to come to the end of my comments, but I was also interested in one more line, which I somehow don't seem to find, which is that he talks about how, yeah, well, I guess illumining some dark corners of our own mind. So there is an agenda, a reformative or provocative, if you will, agenda in his own writing. So that's what I was saying the first time when I spoke a little bit about this project. With all its complexity and possibilities, which is that there is a moment after Bharati. There's a whole history, you know, in the Justice Party, in the Dravidian movement of Ayodhya Das and then Periyar, then DMK politics, then Ambedkar, the whole history through which we are now reconstructing Bharati. Okay? That's the fourth moment, and finally his own position. So my question is this, that isn't it time that Mr. Subramaniam also problematizes his own subject position, because he himself has hinted implicitly at some of his concerns, if not his agenda, if there is any. But in other words, his own text cannot escape that responsibility. That is my point. Because in his project, in his attempt to try to read the multiple layers of Bharati's text, his own multiple layers and his own either concerted or conflicted intentions and agendas are also, as it were, popping up, you know, above the plain surface of the prose. They are also seeking our attention. Jaisa koi class mein vidyarthi saath utha ke kehta hai, mere paas bhi ek prashna hai. To inhi ke dusre jo prarup hai aur mukhote hain, वो उन्हीं के टेक्स्ट के भीतर से अपना हाथ उठा के कहते हैं कि भाई मैं भी हूं, है ना, इस टेक्स्ट इस गल्प में मैं भी मौजूद हूं, मेरा क्या होगा, मेरी आवाज कौन सुनेगा. तो इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ आई इनवाइट यू टू गिव योर चैप्टर. एंड आई जस्ट हैड वन कमेंट एज यू नो वन ऑलवेज एज ही इज आस्क्ड फॉर कमेंट्स एट द एंड. सो वन ऑफ द थिंग्स आई नोटिस अबाउट इंडियन स्कॉलरशिप, you know, I notice many such things, is that we never come to the point. So, you know, first chapter is some background, second chapter is some more background, third chapter is more background. Background matlab us samay kya ho raha tha, temple mein kya. When are we going to come to the point? Because, you see, this is what we do. And sometimes you read the whole work and you don't find out what the point is. Point kya hai? You know, because it's now you can problematize it, you can say it's endless deferral. So I don't see that hermeneutics here at all. This is not a Derridean text by any stretch of the imagination. Okay, but I mean, it would be good to concentrate on Bharati, his opera, and bring out the importance of that text, and that's coming now in chapter 5. So this is just I'm just sharing my feelings. The work is entirely yours. I'm just offering not from the position of a director at all, but just as a fellow scholar or a fellow academic. And in general about how we do things, that the most important thing, this important text which very few people know about, wo chapter 5 mein aaya hai. To matlab isko, अगर आप पूरा इसके साथ इंसाफ करेंगे तो चैप्टर 5 से चैप्टर 15 इसी पे होना चाहिए. तो फिर ये 20 चैप्टर की ये किताब बन जाएगी या ये शोध कार्य बन जाएगा. सो थैंक यू एंड प्लीज डोंट माइंड इफ आई हैव सेड समथिंग दैट बिकॉज आई हैव नो यू नो वी शेयर दीज थॉट्स. ओके प्लीज डोंट माइंड, आई अपोलोजाइज इफ आई हैव हर्ट एनीबडी.
Thank you, Professor Karanthi, for your brilliant observations, and I think I should straight away come to the point. History is becoming a subject on which everybody except the historian has any kind of take in which he could say that I am saying this with any amount of conviction. Historians are always in doubt, looking for more facts, and always trying to qualify his own position. But still, he makes an important point, and that I think a noted historian like Subramaniam will be aware of it, that in this context, when we are looking at such a subject, such as Dalit discourse, and Dalit history, I'm not aware of the entire corpus, entire work as such, but I can really imagine that a historian is always under some kind of pressure to tell the story and narrate in such a way that the dots could be joined. And in that process, writing Dalit history is extremely difficult because, as the other day he was mentioning, that Indian historians do not really offer much to talk about the medieval period when we talk about the history of Dalits. And that is why, as Professor Bharati was mentioning, a text, its presentation and representation, even if after many centuries, becomes a subject around which the historian can bring in different perspectives and in a way try to tell the story the historian should. And that is why this is a very important work in which a text of 12th century, retold in 19th century, provides a certain prospect or certain possibility to talk about the history of Dalits. In fact, obviously, it would be bringing the local history, I mean, the context in which this entire history is to be told. And therefore, we look forward to this fascinating story of Nandanar, through which we can look back and talk many things about not only the context it talks about, but also the Dalit history, understanding of the past, and various ways in which we can imagine, reimagine, present, and represent the history of Dalits. And therefore, I do not waste time and just move towards Dr. Subramanian's presentation. He always objects to this, that he is not a doctorate. I don't know whether he is or not, but he is a very, very refined historian, I believe. And about that, he cannot object. We all are familiar with this.
That's your subjective.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And I think, thank you very much. I'm saying it, assuming that this is going to be a fascinating discussion. A presentation and a discussion. I'm really delighted that Dr. Ajay Kumar is with us today. And he's a historian. He's not a historian, but he keeps always huge interest in these kind of subjects. I don't know where from he has come. I'm very delighted. Over to
Dr. Subramanian. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Paranjpe. Thank you, Dr. Patel, for nice words. I start by remembering my old friend, Dr. Vijaya Ramaswamy, who was here when I made my first presentation. And I hope she is listening to it somewhere and give me her critical feedback to whatever means she chooses. Let me begin with a little about what I have done here. I think that was to me an important thing. I had read this text and worked on this text for quite a while. But when I came to the institute, I thought I'll try to keep my history away and look at how people who study literature, literary critics, and people who write look at texts. And I tried to browse through the library and pick up some books, mainly to understand what is literary theory and how do you look at pieces of literature. As a historian, we have a very simple approach to literature. We look at literature as source of history. You get such and such an information. Is that information authentic? Does it tell you about those people? And looking at literary theory, particularly the 20th century formalists and other literary theory, it opened a new avenue for me, and I had to unlearn a lot of things which I as a historian have imbibed. Dr. Hada is here, and I think he, in every intervention that he has made this point that look at literature as literature and not through an extraneous standard of either sociology or philosophy or religion. Look at literature as a literary work. What does it mean? That's what I have been trying to look at, and that has helped me a lot to understand a text like this. Dr. Paranjpe made this point, and I think that's what I was going to begin with. And I'll call it, in traditional sense, we say disclosure. Disclosure about myself and my intents in the work. I come from an extremely privileged social background. Middle class, Brahmin, male. You can't get higher than that in the pecking order very easily. In an Indian society, that really is the most privileged segment. And I'm trying to talk about the most deprived segment of the society. Now, a good Brahmanic text will always tell you who the Adhikari Bheva. Who is entitled to engage with this text? And there will be a set of norms. You ought to have studied, you ought to have this kind of disposition. But at the beginning of all that would be, you have to be of such and such a caste. If you are a Brahmin, you can do so much. If you are so and so, you can do so much. Modern Dalit literature, or Dalit movement, actually inverses this. And we are told that being a Brahmin, you cannot start representing or talking about Dalits or telling Dalits what they are, what their problem is. We all know that there was a huge controversy around Arundhati Roy's introduction and editing of Dr. Ambedkar's Annihilation of Caste. But a young Dalit activist, of friend of mine, she gave me a very interesting advice, which I really hold as very valuable in this. She said, what you can do, instead of telling us about us, is to tell the upper caste what they have done to the society. Tell them what they have done, rather than tell Dalits what they are. There's a difference. Holding a mirror to the upper caste, being one yourself. So that is my first disclosure, that I engage with this question with a certain disqualification of not being someone from that community or from being the opposite kind of a community in the privileged. That is one. The second disclosure is my training as a historian has been as a Marxist historian. I think the director, when he introduced me in the first time, he introduced me as a Marxist. And he was right. My training as a historian has been as a Marxist. And Marxist historiography and Marxists in general have been notorious for ignoring the caste issue in Indian history. And that has been the whole problem, because Marxists always think class is the issue, class conflict is the issue, and therefore caste doesn't figure in, and caste does figure, but as a kind of add on to it, but it's not really in the focus. Even though some of the best Marxists, like Professor Arash Sharma, Professor Vivekanand Jha, Professor Sudhira Jaiswal, have written whatever little that exists on the history of caste and understanding. But unfortunately, like I was telling you, all the stops somewhere in 600 AD or something. What happened in the medieval period when actually the caste formation that we see today took shape, the entire historiography is virtually silent. There are very few people. There's one like Fukuzawa who worked on documents from Maharashtra. Some people who write half a chapter, quarter of a chapter on caste issues in different states, but I won't go into the review of that. But what I'm saying is that both by my birth, my upbringing, and by my professional training, caste has always had a marginal or, you know, it's not an important thing in the field. So unlearning all this and engaging with caste has been an issue. And you can all read into my, whatever I say, these kind of issues, upper caste apologia for caste system, you can say a Marxist attempt at shifting the gaze from caste discrimination to issues of class, all this is quite possible. With this disclosure, I begin with my talk. As I had mentioned, भैया वो बैटरी लो बता रहा है इसका बिजली सिस्टम का है ओके आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट एंड quickly go over this particular thing I had introduced in my note. This is about Gopal Krishna Bharati, who was, as you can see the date, he was a 19th century person. He was a Brahmin, Bhakta Vagyayakara. Vagyayakara means music composer, where you not just compose the notes, but you also compose the lyric. Basically, a Vagyayakara composes lyrics set to music. But he was a very uncharacteristic, unorthodox kind of a Brahmin and musician, because he was not attached to any court. He was a person who was constantly on the move. He never married. He remained an ashtik brahmachari. He used to compose, sit in people's houses, sing songs, teach students, go to another city, sit there, live there for a few weeks, and go on to another place. He never had a home of his own. He basically lived off many of his admirers. Basically, that is the kind of a person. And in his travels, he met a number of people, interacted with a whole range of people. He devoted a lot of time in this Chidambaram temple, which is a center of my concern. So he was a very uncharacteristic Brahmin. Yeah? So that uncharacteristicness, we'll see how it operates. But he was a Brahmin. Yeah? So, and the Brahmanic frame of thought was very central to the way he visualized. Second is, he's a pariah of the 19th century. the pariah he was trying to represent was actually torn between two epochs. Epoch one was like what he was represented in the early medieval or medieval text, and the pariah he himself wanted to represent in his text was the contemporary 19th century pariah. The contemporary 19th century pariah was not just an untouchable person, but he was also a slave and an agrestic slave. An agrestic slave is one who is working in agriculture. So this adds a totally new dimension to his depiction of a pariah person. Third is the genre that he chose, the kind of literature. You call it an opera, but actually it is intended for a musical performance. Usually it's a single man with mridangam or some accompanies. And this person, a kathakar, he does a katha. He sings a song, he explains, he interacts with the audience. So it's a combination of songs, texts, different kinds of musical genre that we use. And it dramatizes the whole thing so that the same, this gives him an opportunity to depict the Nandana story as a drama played out by different kind of people. So he brings in the character of a landlord, he brings in the character of fellow pariahs, he brings in the character of God himself. So various people are interacting with this pariah person. So you get to see how these various people are looking at this pariah. So this musical genre gives the opportunity to create a different environment other than a narrative. It's not a plain narrative. It's a multiple vision that he brings in. Who was he intending as his audience? I mean, it was sponsored by some chettiars and merchants, wealthy chettiars in Karaikal town. It was published by the efforts of a French official in Karaikal. And it was performed by a huge number of musicians and dancers down the ages. But my own reading of it, I get this feeling that he was intending the Brahmins of his own time as the audience. He wanted them to know that this is what we have done to the world. I think, I mean, this is my kind of projection. And of course, now you come to the period after him. That's a long period of more than 100 years, 150 years have gone by. So a number of people have used the text. I won't go into that. So this was composed in 1860. It was a transition to the emergence of the British Empire, because just British had just taken over the region that he was living in, the Tanjavur district. Earlier it was under the Marathas, and still earlier under the Vijayanagara Nayakas. So the Marathas were different from the Peshwai Marathas. Peshwai Marathas were the orthodox Brahmanic Peshwas, but these were the Shivaji Bhosle Marathas. So they were not the orthodox Peshwai kind of Marathas. It was a very important, like Gaikwad or even Sindhias. They were Marathas, but they were not subscribing to the kind of orthodoxy. I mean, they were quite orthodox themselves, but they're not subscribing to the kind of orthodoxy that the Peshwas do. So there is a slight difference. He is sitting in a transition period between the Marathas and the coming of the British. And just a few decades before he comes into operation, slavery has been officially been abolished, but nothing has been done about it. it has not been implemented on the ground. It gets implemented only after 1860s or 1870s when rules are formulated for it. So slavery and agrestic slavery continues in this period when he is writing, and it's quite important. So this is the kind of a background, and I'll now go on to So Nandana Charitra Kirtanai is a text rich in details and seeks to create prototypes of pariahs and others to enable the nature of the transgression by Nandanar to stand out. Nandanar is no radical liberal, but a conformist who simply seeks the right to worship Shiva and visit temples dedicated to him without even trying to enter them. However, this limited desire threatens to bring down the social edifice, which he tries to his best to keep going. He doesn't want to disturb the social edifice. This tension provides Gopalakrishna Bharati the opportunity to create a typecast of pariahs and Brahmin landlords. In this typecasting, there is a negotiation between a received normative idea of outcast pariah, pariahs Bharati had encountered in real life, and his own notion of an ideal pariah. There are three different kind of ways in which you can conceptualize pariah. In reading the following pages on the representation of the pariah in NCK, NCK's Nandanar Charitra Kirtanai, I just shortened it, we should keep in mind this tension and the need to create a foil for transgressive behavior of Nandanar. It's an upper caste Brahmin, albeit a dissident Brahmin representation, and certainly not the self-image of the pariahs themselves or even an ethnographic account. The story is set in two locales. Adanur is the birthplace and residence of Nandanar, and Chidambaram, which he wants to visit for a darshan of Nataraj. Bharati seems to move across times between the drama played out in the village of Adanur and the climax of the story in Chidambaram. The village of Adanur, its Brahmin landlord and pariah agricultural laborers, including Nandanar, appear to be a 19th century village of Brahmin mirasdars, while Chidambaram goes back to a timeless past when the Pulaya Thirunalai Povar, another name of Nandanar, may have tried to make his entry into the temple. This anachronism was a deliberate device that he used to pose the question of pariahs before the audience. In placing a timeless Pulaya devotee in here and now enabled him to describe the lives and the alienation of the contemporary untouchables to an audience which is well aware of it but equally indifferent to it. Bharati further uses a set of devices made available to him by the operatic form he adopted. The most important among them is the multiple gaze. I have already talked about it. Gaze of the landlord, the gaze of the fellow pariahs, gaze of Nandanar himself as he reflected on his own fate. Finally, the gaze of Shiva, who intervenes at crucial points. In addition, we have the benefit of the gaze of a bhakta, that is Bharati himself. These multiple gazes give us diverse, complementary, and at times conflicting images, some of which can be tantalizingly fleeting. The defamiliarization of paraya that he achieves as a consequence leaves us disturbed and thinking. The authorial intent of Bharati may have been much more modest and conservative, and we can see his Brahmanic frames of thinking circumscribing the radical consequences of literary efforts. What I'm trying to point out here is, when you try to represent something which you encounter every day, normal thing, which you internalize, like what you call it's a rote learned reality. Dalit hote hai, untouchable hote hai, aise hote hai. Theek hai, that is it. You don't give a second thought. But when you talk of Dalit in all the complexity of that person's life and put him in a bhakti situation. So you start looking at this Dalit person who you encounter every day, and you are taking him for granted you start looking at him in a different way. That's what is called in literary theory as defamiliarizing reality. The reality which you have virtually stopped seeing is brought back to you with a new, as if you're looking at it for the first time. Okay, the next point. So there is a methodological problem that I again want to share with you before I go on to that. Bharati's overt project, which he announces at the beginning of his work, was to prove that caste status was of no consequence in bhakti. He was equally convinced that a Dalit could engage in bhakti while being a social conformist. This is precisely what he sets out to demonstrate in the story of Nandan. But by placing agrestic slavery and Brahmanic casteist landlordism in the limelight, he opens possibilities far beyond what was his intention. The vivid multi-pronged description of the subject under its dramatic form at once defamiliarizes these institutions which were taken for granted. But before we proceed, a methodological caution may be in order. The NCK, the images of Nandanar the Bhakta, and the Nandanar representative pariah of 19th century village, are so intricately interwoven that separating the latter to gain an insight into the life of pariahs may be a difficult task. One can apply filters up to a point to separate them, but when it comes to the world of emotions and feelings, one cannot get entry into one without the other. We are necessarily to see the mind of the typical pariah through the atypical bhakta's emotional outpourings. Okay, now I come to, like Professor Paranjpe said, now I come to the point. Now, Varnashrama is defined by the opposition between the touchable Varnas on the one hand and untouchable Parayas on the other hand. The idealized locale of the story, Adanur, is defined by the opposition not only between the habitat of Ur and Gramam and the agricultural fields, but also between Ur inhabited by the touchable Varnas and the Cheri, or a colony as it is called today, inhabited by the untouchable people. There is this description of Adanur village which I have projected. Adanur Gramam, with its mansions and pavilions and towers and Kuta arches, designed to defeat celestial cities like Amarapuri and Alakapattanam, vagara vagara, with Vedic practitioners endowed with 8 siddhis like Anima, with full of overflowing wealth, insights, deeper meaning, vagara vagara vagara. Resulting with the other 3 castes of the Varnashrama, that is Vaishya, Kshatriya and Shudra. In the outside of this village, in the open spaces surrounded by paddy fields, was the habitation or cheri of the terminal jati. So the terminal jati lives outside the village, and that's what defines the village and the cheri together. A gramam and cheri are always counterposed to each other. When I say I'm going to the gramam, I mean I'm going to the village of the upper caste. When I say I'm going to cheri, I'm going to the colony of the Dalits. In contrast between Gramam and Cheri define both. The Ur or Gramam is the habitat of the 4 touchable castes headed by Brahmins, while the Cheri is its other, the habitat of the terminal caste. The two are in necessary defining relation with each other. The Cheri exists to serve and make possible the wealth and holiness of the Gramam, which commands and controls the Cheri and keeps it as a Cheri. The spatial segregation between the two is essential to the form of control, namely untouchability, which is also central to the identity of the 4 upper castes. This is much more than the clustering of residences and of professionals which may happen within the space of Grama. Cheri is very distinct kind of segregation which defines the untouchable status of its residents. Dr. Ambedkar, in a debate in Legislative Assembly, once said, "I am not part of the whole, I am a part apart." Which he is basically saying that I am not part of India. I am outside of India, but I am related to India. But this conflicting situation, which he brings out with a very simple, beautiful, elegant phrase, part apart. That's what a cheri is. It's a part of the village, but it's not part of the whole of the village. It's out of it. Bharati uses the term used in Periya Puranam, this is the 12th century work, Pulai Padi, and he closely follows the Periya Puranam descriptions. Thatched roofs covered in bottle gourd vines, barking dogs, kites hovering for meat pieces, cocks crying aloud, children prancing around with iron belts. Iron belts are important because Manu had only allowed iron as ornament for Dalits. Drunken people joyously singing, etc., etc. He also adds significant details to underline the carrion and leather processing activities, rotting flesh, tanks, the stinking hides, drying sinews and bleached bones. The autonomy of the cheri is reflected in the drunkenness, the singing of certain kinds of songs, playing of drums, and the general atmosphere of abandonment. Mollusks and fishes being important component of their diet. We are told about fishes drying outside the pathways and crabs breeding in the ponds. The Periya Puranam sought to emphasize the prosperity, joyousness, and virility of the Pulaya workforce. NCK emphasizes the non-vegetarian and non-Brahmanic ethos of the cheri. The commonality between them is the ethnographic gaze, which looks at the other kind of settlement as a curiosity. Oh, you can't hear me. Okay, then I come to the next point, food and drink. Food and drink constitute major markers of caste status and orthodoxy. Thus, the NCK time and again refers to the food consumed by the pariahs. They were primarily non-vegetarian, given to heavy intake of liquor is repeatedly underscored. While meat is supposed to fatten them and liquor is supposed to be effective in dulling their minds. The tradition of our kula is to trap crabs, eat meat and drink toddy. We are the lowly jati fattened on meat and with the brain dulled and gait unsteady due to the drinking of toddy day in and day out. Such, even among the non-vegetarian foods, lowly food like crabs and snails characterized paraya diet, which marked their lowly status. Snail slurping paraya was used as an abuse. Of course, the ultimate marker of the otherness of the pariahs was the beef eating. Beef eating pulaya too was an abuse and a matter of fact statement. It's repeated a number of times in the text. The NCK repeatedly refers to toddy, drinking of toddy, kallu, kadi, madhu, and its dulling impact on the intellect of the pariahs, but also occasionally it mentions it as a remedy for the physical pain of rough, tough toil in the fields. In most of the references to food habit, it's not a matter-of-fact statement, but used to denote the lowliness of the entire untouchable community. So the repeated use of these descriptions as an adjunct to the jati term pulaya and paraya. Maadu thinnum pulaya, natte urinjum paraya, kaadiyai kudida paraya. So whenever the lowliness of the food is mentioned, the name paraya is always coupled with it to emphasize the, how they go together. Not only were these attributes considered as characteristic of the pariahs, they were recommended to the pariahs as their normative behavior instead of trying to adopt the behavior of upper castes. There was no reformist agenda ke sab nahi khana chahiye. They were told that yehi khana chahiye taki aap alag rahe. That you have to remain distinct by consuming these foods. If you start eating the other food and you start bridging the gap, then farak kya rahe jayega. One of the traditional markers of paraya status, acha, how much time do I have? Okay. I'll skip the next and go through. So that's one thing about food. Then second thing about names. This Manu recommending for us, for a Brahmin, the name should be something auspicious, for a Kshatriya so-and-so. And for a Shudra, Jugupsa, repulsion should be indicated in the personal names of people. Or service. I mean, there is another quotation which I have not brought in here. Either they should Jugupsa hona chahiye, ya that should be service indicated, like Das. The term Das is always used for. But he does not say what should be the names of Antyajas, because unka ta namkaran sanskari nahi ho sakta, so we don't enter into the picture. So you can see the kind of names that are used for the Dalits in this text. There are about 20 personal names which figure. You can see when someone is Saab, someone is Tondu, someone is Hathi Chara, then local goddess, various kinds of, some of them will give you, you know, a feel of revulsion also. So these are the kind of names that they are entitled to. Typically, the NCK does not mention any second name for the Parayas, which may indicate their Kula or family. The Paraya status may imply an absence of lineage, which was necessary only in cases where excess of power and inheritance of property was involved. I come to the next one, which is more important, which is on work. Manu, as we know, defined a person by his birth and by the work. So who is to do what work is very essential in Brahmanic thinking. So the quintessential chandala, untouchable, that the chandalas were, they are confined to certain kind of work, which Manu has said here. I will not repeat that. Mainly it relates to leather scavenging and removal of dead bodies, execution. These are the kind of work they are supposed to do. Later on, this was extended to leather work, and leather was considered a hallmark of Dalit work. Well, leather work was their normative identity, both in Periyapuranam and then NCK. Pulayas and Parayas were also engaged as agricultural workers. Even though leather work helped to define the Pulayas as untouchables, the reality was that the principal economic rationale for their existence was to provide agricultural labor. Agricultural work was a respectable Kshatriya occupation and could not have been categorized as lowly or untouchable. Hence, the reference to leather work becomes mandatory to explain the caste status. Actually, now there has been a lot of research, even in states like UP, what were called United Provinces, where chamars, who are traditionally considered to be leather workers, and leather industry supposed to be associated with chamars. Now we have evidence to show, and people have worked on it, that majority of the chamars were actually doing agriculture. Either they were agricultural workers or they actually owned land also. So that they were actually doing agriculture. Agriculture within the caste norms is not an outcast or an untouchable work. But chamars remain untouchable and continue to do agriculture as the principal activity that they do. This you see even in the NCK. And this happened somewhere in the late medieval period, this transformation of Dalit untouchable communities into agricultural communities happens in the medieval period. That's what I was telling him about, that there is a total silence on how this happened. And we need to really uncover this process. In line with the theory, okay, I'll skip that. Tell you more about our kind. Why is agriculture so central? Because you can see the details of every single agricultural work is being listed as the task of Nandana and his community. This repeatedly detailed out what is the kind of work, and I've roughly given some kind of work there. I'll not repeat that, but every single agricultural operation is listed and pointed out as the duty of the Dalit, this particular caste of people. Okay, I'll skip the details here, but this little sculpture is from a temple, 20th century, probably middle of 20th century. Now, this actually makes it a kind of a misnomer within the caste system. The problem is that, it's at least in the South Indian caste system, agriculture was the preserve of the Vellalas. Vellalas were the respectable middle caste. They are called the Shatsudras, and if you know something about South Indian caste system, there are only Brahmins and the Vellalas and the Dalits. So you have the three major groups. So the most respectable caste is the Vellala, whose main claim to fame is that they are the people who do tilling of the land and sustain the whole world. They are the sustainer of the world, that is their self-image. But when I come to 19th century, majority of the Vellalas have ceased to even do the plowing. And all agricultural operations in these tracts, I mean, I'm talking about the deltaic, wet irrigated lands, not all all of South India, where this story is taking place. The Vellalas and the Brahmins are the landlords, and they have more or less given up agriculture. There may be, of course, poor peasants among the Vellalas who continue to do agriculture. But principal agricultural labor is being done by the Dalits. So, and this is very important because ritually, the Vellalas consider themselves as agricultural people. And that shift is very important. So in this particular society, say in medieval times, medieval historians have tried to give us an image that even in a Brahmadeya village, given as grant to Brahmins, there'll be a Brahmin landlord, there'll be a Vellala cultivating peasant and the agricultural labor of the Dalits. So they have a three-tier system. But when I come to the NCK in the 19th century, there are only two tiers. There are no Vellala intermediaries between the landlord and the peasant. So there is landlord on the one side who is a Brahmin, and then there is the landless, untouchable agricultural labor on the other end. I'll just show you this picture. This is 1899 edition of this book. So you have this illustration, which shows different kinds of agricultural workers, work being done by the Parayas. The central figure there is a Brahmin landlord, Chutaiya wale Pandit ji, you can see. He is directing the operations, but you can see all the rest, they are the Dalit agricultural workers. So I just mentioned of those chamars, I'll skip that slide. And then I come to the another important aspect of it. The Dalits are not just working as agricultural laborers, but they are agricultural slaves. They are brought and sold. So the slavery is very central to that relationship. So I'll talk a little about this problem of slavery represented here. The relationship between landlord and workers repeatedly termed as one between Andai and Adimai. Adimai means slave, Andai means lord, which can be loosely translated as master and slave. While introducing us to Nandana, the NCK tells us that there was a slave paraya of the Vaidyar of Andanar. So the fact that he was a slave is repeatedly mentioned in the text. The implication here is that Nandanar was a personal slave of Vaidya, and Vaidya means the Brahmin. Ved se Vaidyar bante hain. And different parayas are held as slaves by different owners. Conversely, Vaidya is referred to as Andai or master. Slavery, unlike caste status, is an acquired status. The Vaidya landlord reminds Nandanar at one point, are you not the Parayan who wrote your own Muri and came to me? Wrote your own Muri means you signed a deed and you came to me as a dead bondage or whatever, you sold yourself to me or something. It's not very clear whether he actually sold himself or whether he was a hereditary slave who was made to renew his slave bondage by each generation. You look at the documents in 19th century, it's very clear that there is actually no loan transaction. It's simply that 5 rupees advance de diya aur sign kara liya ki bhai aap hamare hereditary slave ho. So that kind of a bondage, it's called technically a slave debt bondage, but actually it's a kind of a relationship of hereditary slave. In addition, there is also a market in slaves. Till 1860s, there is a very active market in slaves. Buying and selling of slaves is going on. So there is a variety of possibilities of how you could have become a slave. So I'm just hinting at that. Okay. What did this relation of Andai and Adimai entail? It certainly demanded complete obedience on the part of slave towards the master and compliance of all orders to be available at their beck and call. This is different from being an untouchable, simple untouchable status. The status of a slave means you are personally answerable to this person. So whatever he asks you to do, you have to do it. So Nandanar says, I'll do as you say. And then in a moment of rebelliousness, he says, I am not a slave of this chap. I am the slave of God. And so on and so forth. So that obedience to the Lord or the master is very central to this relationship of agrestic slavery. The more dependent and personalized the relation, greater flexibility it allowed to the landlord over labor. The Vaidya explicates it like this. Being dependent as a confidant and my own paraya. That tum mere ho, tum mere paraya ho, to hum aur tumhare beech mein ghanisht rishta hai. That element of personal relationship is very important. I'll skip certain modes of remuneration here because it's not very well developed. But the most important import of this relationship of Andai and Adimai revolves around the control of the master over the mobility of the slave. You know, that you cannot move without my permission. If I was just an ordinary, untouchable agricultural worker, I'm free to go anywhere. I want to go to a temple, I can go to a temple. Whether I enter the temple or not, it's a different. I go to a market, I can go to a market. But here, I had to seek permission to go. If the master does not permit me, I cannot go. So that control over mobility is very central. And it's expressed in a different... Because Nandanar wants to go to Chidambaram to see the temple. And the master tells him, you cannot go until all the 250 acres of land have been plowed and the product has been, you know, brought to my home. So that mobility is controlled, that is the point. The second point is, and then I'll not go into the details of this. Second point is the power to punish and discipline the slave. This is the second very important. You can see that image of this Brahmin lord is actually caning Nandana. Daadi mooch wale jo hai Nandana. This is again a mid-20th century sculptural representation from a Dalit temple in Chidambaram itself. So, the other fellow pariahs who are opposed to Nandanar go to the Brahmin landowner and tell him, he catch him, beat him, scold him, and control and rule over him because he is transgressing. So this is what is expected of the master. You catch him and discipline him, beat him. You who work as an adhime, do you think you are entitled to so much excitement and fun? Will I not restrain and rule over you? This is what the master tells him. If you insist again, I'll beat you and reduce your wages. Do I need to repeatedly deny you permission? Aren't you my slave? I have the means to show you. And if you answer back, I'll slap you. Of course, he cannot slap because he was an antithesis. But he uses a cane eventually. So this kind of violent control over the body of the untouchable is very central. Add to it is the what I will call, it's very central to caste system. It's the insulting the untouchable. Repeatedly subjecting the Dalit to an insult. It's very central to maintain the caste hierarchy. This has been ethnographically reported and reported so much in the fiction that you see. So, and Bharati himself, who is otherwise generally a good conformist Brahmin, but when this comes to the insult part, he tries to distance himself. And he distances himself by saying, this Vaidya, because he had bought Nandanar in a market, he thought he could tell him anything that came to his mind. Then he says, usne jo bhi gali galoch, he lists all the gali. Basically, the gali is around waiting, then the kind of food they eat and the their behavior. And so saying, so there is a string of galis which I will not repeat here. So saying, he hit him with stones, beat him with a stick, and scolded him with words, and that stung like scorpion. Scorpion, kya bolte hai? Bichhu ki kaat jaise jo man mein bura lagta ho, aise insults. So this, the sheer physical violence and heaping of denigrating personal insult becomes the ultimate and decisive combination of domination and exploitation. Okay. Paraya status. What did... Now I come back to the caste status. So far we had talked about the slavery part. One typical thing that Dalit is supposed to do on immediately citing a social superior of whichever age group, वो एकदम दंडवत होना पड़ता है. सो दिस दंडवतनेस इज रिपीटेड एंड शोन इन अ नंबर ऑफ कॉन्टेक्स्ट. ही इज नॉट सपोज्ड टू लुक देम इन देयर आईज बट कीप देयर आईज लो. यू कैन सी दैट इन दिस इमेज फ्रॉम दिस टेम्पल. आंख नीचे, नजर कभी उठा के नहीं देखना चाहिए, वगैरह वगैरह वगैरह. वन इज द फिजिकल बॉडी लैंग्वेज ऑफ अ दलित हैज टू बी वेरी क्लियरली submissive compared to the body language of the other caste. His speech was expected to be self-deprecatory. Baisa, main kya hoon, main to nachis hoon. That kind of a speech. So whenever Nandanar will speak to his superiors, he will always say, ki bhai, main to aise neech jaat ka hoon, I am ignorant, I am good for nothing. But most important is the polluting presence of this person. Don't touch, don't speak here, don't yell, don't stand there, don't see me, don't climb the stairs, don't enter, don't come. These are the things which a Dalit is supposed to heard constantly all through his life. This is where the superiors reside. And this is internalized by the lower caste, the Dalits themselves. The second quotation is Nandanar himself telling himself, this is where the superiors reside. It's not proper for me. My body is so polluted, it's like a dead body, born of a paraya caste to be there. When he sees Chidambaram city full of the Brahmin households doing yajna and all. He feels, I cannot enter this place. This is a polluted body. I can't enter this complex with this body. But then he's always bothered by this tormenting word, you know, what he calls the Dan Paraya Movie. I mean, if I translate in Tamil, if you're a Tamil, you'll understand what it actually means to hear something like that. So the next little bit will be on access to religion. Chandala is outside all dharma, is what a lot of Smritikaras say, Yagyavalkya, Gautama, vagera, vagera. The Parayars are entitled only to worship the folk deities with bali, toddy, possession, vagera, vagera. I'll show this. This is again an image from 1920 version of the story. You can see certain women preparing pongal. That is one. The number of small folk deities and then the folk priest attending to them. So this is the kind of religion they were entitled to. There's one thing which I had missed out earlier. In the entire agricultural operation, is very crucially dependent upon satisfying the folk deities. Jo gram devta hai, jo agriculture se related devta hai, you have to propitiate them at every step. And this can only be done by the Dalit. The Brahmin priest cannot officiate there. So the actual production process is held together by the worship done by the Dalits. It's not the Brahmins who are holding the worship of these deities. Brahmins are only worshipping the greater deities who will take you out of this world, you know, whatever. Bhavsagar paar karane wale log jo hain, wo devta jo hain, wo Brahmin poochte hain. Khet mein jo production hoga, that is handled by the Dalits. Okay, this is a very interesting contrast. And when Nandanar is asking that, mujhe bhi bhavsagar paar karna hai, so I also want to worship the same God. Agar Shiv is going to take me out of the bhavsagar, I want to worship him. So this is the transgression that he is doing. Baki sab to he is agreeing to do. He is saying, main kheti kar lunga, ye kar lunga, aapki baat sab maan lunga, but mujhe bhavsagar paar lagna. So this is where the That is where the Vaidyat keeps telling him, bhai, tum to paraya ho, you are not entitled to it. Bhakti tumhare liye nahi hai, siddhi tumhare liye, shiv pad tumhare liye nahi hai. And the fellow parayas also tell him, bhai, ye to unke bhagwan hai. Panditon ke bhagwan hai, apne ko fayda nahi karenge. And this is what the fellow parayas tell him, ki bhai, they are gods of the upper caste, you know, why? Let us worship our own gods. Why are you going there? Okay, so. Sorry, I'm going back. So, when Nandanar, as he's shown, he says, look, I am not violating any of your rules. मैं कोई मंदिर के अंदर नहीं घुस रहा हूं आप बोलते हो बाहर से भगवान को देख लो मैं बाहर से दर्शन करता हूँ यू से दैट हमारे यहाँ जो टेम्पल चैरियट फेस्टिवल होता है साल में एक आध बार होता है द गॉड इज ब्रॉट आउट इन द चैरियट हैज टू बी ड्रॉन बाय दलित्स बिकॉज इतना मेहनत कौन करे बिकॉज इट रिक्वायर्स हंड्रेड्स ऑफ पीपल और एक्चुअली थाउजेंड्स ऑफ पीपल टू एंड डेज ऑफ पुलिंग of the chariot because they are huge ones. So it takes a lot of effort. So that is when a Dalit is entitled to get a darshan of this god. So he is saying that I'll go for this darshan on this chariot festival. I'll go to the temple, stand outside and come back. I won't go in. So he is not challenging the existing norms. He just wants to do this. But this again, his lord, he keeps telling you, "Yaar, tum to beef eater ho, tum jaake mandir mein jaoge, tum Bhagwan ko dekhne jaoge." So this kind of insults he gets in. So now this is the broad picture that you get of the Dalit community, what they were entitled to do, what they were not entitled to do, what they did. Now I come to their mindset and what they felt they ought to do. I'll just take 5 minutes, hopefully. And I'll finish there. The NCK oscillates between the images of conformism and protest. The ideal pariah slave who accepts the condition heaped upon him, the pariah who can't take it anymore, and the pariah who appears to resolve this tension at a spiritual plane. Dandanar uses his caste identity as a leather worker to supply commodity, leather goods to the temples, agara vagara. I'll skip this part and go into it. But I'll come to the main point, which is even as he's trying to be conformist, he constantly is troubled by the fact that why am I belonging, why this treatment to me? He's not able to digest, even though he's internalized it through generations of training, but somewhere it just doesn't work. There is this element of protest. Why should I take it? I can't take it, kind of thing. So constantly thinking of the lowliness of my caste, grieving, my heart distressed and wilting. I mean, I'm a very bad translator, but the original text is far more moving in its emotions. Birth which is gone by people of this country. I don't want this birth. I don't mind any other birth. I don't want this birth in which people of the world utter the soul tormenting words, O sinful pariah, move away. ये जो सोल टॉर्मेंटिंग वर्ड मैंने लिखा है वो एक्चुअली इट्स अ बैड ट्रांसलेशन आई डोंट नो हाउ टू इवन से इट इन इंग्लिश कि आपका जी तड़पता है ना किसी चीज को सुन के वो तड़प जो है रोज मैं सुनता हूँ इस चीज को और मेरे तड़पता है आत्मा तड़पती है जिससे एंड ही सेज कि जब मैं लोग मेरे से कहते हैं तुम दूर भागो मेरी आत्मा तड़पती है एंड दैट अ पर्सन हु इज सो लॉयल हु इज सो मच इंटरनलाइज्ड द कास्ट आइडियोलॉजी हिमसेल्फ बट ही कैन नॉट बट रिएक्ट टू दिस एज अ ह्यूमन बीइंग द ह्यूमैनिटी ऑफ हिम कीप्स असर्टिंग हिम But even, there is something interesting in this whole text. When he is protesting, he's always protesting either in alone to himself or when he's talking to fellow or when he's talking to God. But when he's addressing his social superiors, he's always the Huzur and my Bab kind of language. Except in one or two places where that protest element does come in. Okay, I'll skip a lot of that and I come to the last thing on the project of emancipation. The project of Nandanar clearly was one of liberation of pariah from the shackles of caste and also from what he took to be shackles of cycles of rebirth common to all human beings. Jo Bhavsagar wali baat hai, he keeps saying that, you know, Bhavsagar paar lagna hai, ye janam janam wale chakkar se mujhe bahar nikalna hai. But that is the normal trope which the entire bhakti literature will give you. But he's adding to it the fact that doing bhakti will enable you to get out of the status of being an untouchable. So that is very important to his whole thinking. Even if born as pariah, we can aspire for liberation. That is the first thing he tells his fellow people. Paragati, paragati means ki dusri gati ya. प्राप्त कर सकते इवन दो वी आर परेयर्स वी कैन गेट आउट ऑफ दिस एंड देन व्हाट इज इंपॉर्टेंट नंदनार इज नॉट जस्ट टॉकिंग अबाउट हिज पर्सनल एमांसिपेशन इफ यू लुक एट पेरिय पुराणम देर इज ओनली नंदनार हु इज ट्राइंग टू रीच गॉड एंड नथिंग टू डू विद रेस्ट ऑफ द कम्युनिटी बट इन दिस 19th सेंचुरी टेक्स्ट The Nandanar's relationship with the community becomes very important and he is constantly interacting with the community as a whole, persuading the fellow pariahs to join him. And the status of being a pariah and how to get out of it is very important in this. So the last thing is about the unresolved tension. The neat distinction between conforming to caste-based norms for the body and society in accessing divinity spiritually, which is what is recommended by Gopal Krishna Bharati. You be a good conformist Dalit, but Bhagwan ko pray karo to aap kaun jaoge upko. So combining conformity with access, equal access to God is what Gopal Krishna Bharati is recommending. But this doesn't work. No? On the one hand, injustice, exploitation, dehumanization inherent in social sphere keeps intruding into the narrative. And on the other hand, caste and class norms cannot permit access to divinity equally to all. Accessing divinity undermines the inequality and injustice inherent in social relations. But Ishwar se bhakti, once you start doing it, that you have to talk about equality and you have to get out of that relationship of subordination and exploitation. So actually you can't do Ishwar Bhakti and yet subject yourself physically to a relationship which is unequal. Which is what keeps coming up in the text, which is not intended by the author. The internalization of the ideas of inequality and subordination, the tensions that inequality and dehumanization create within a human being, an expression of the tension in spiritual realm and its eventual impact on social and productive relations creates the ground for the drama. Nandana's last struggle was against himself. His internalization of caste status versus his conviction that he can do bhakti and achieve vision of God. The NCK's resolution of separation of polluted pariah body and pure Shiva Samana soul. Basically, what happens in the end of the story is God comes and tells the Brahmins in the dream, custodians of the temple, you light a fire and he will pass through the fire. Nandanar will pass through the fire and he will shed his pulaya body or pariah body and assume the right body to enter the temple. So that's what happens.
Brahman Rishi.
A Brahman Rishi banke bahar nikalte. Wo pulaya hote hue wo mandir ke andar nahi ghus paate. This is Choka Mela ke saath bhi yahi hota hai. It's a common story. The resolution of separation of the polluted body and pure soul, which helped the good Brahmanic authors of Periya Puranam and NCK to keep their conscience, has never been acceptable to the Dalit folklore. The folklore accounts of the story, which are different from all this, Dandanar enters the temple in his pariah body, enters the sanctum and eventually merges with Icon with the same polluted body. And folklore invariably has an element in it. In Dalit imagination, the feet of Nandanar continues to stick out of the body of Shiva. कि वो पूरा अंदर तो गया नहीं तो थोड़ा उनका टांग जो है बाहर निकला हुआ है. यू कैन सी दोस टू स्कार्फ लाइक थिंग ऑन द साइड. सो इट इज इन द दलित वर्शन इट्स एक्चुअली द रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द फीट ऑफ नंदन. वो पूरा अंदर नहीं गया, वो दो अभी भी बाहर निकला हुआ है. और ये लोग जो पूजा करते हैं, they are actually also worshipping the polluted body of Nandana. That is the folklore imagination. Thus, the polluting pariah body is part of the object of worship. That is it. Thank you.
Thank you. For really engaging presentation. And I did interrupt him because I thought that this presentation is so engrossing that it should be completed. And normally what we do, 1 hour for presentation and 1 hour for discussion. But that is not possible because we started...
Actually, I started at 3:30.
So there are other kind of things which come into the play. So we actually took slightly more than 1 hour. So this is a fair atmosphere. And I think we can go beyond five for discussion, because I'm sure that many of us would like to comment on it. And it's about reading, just I'm reading one thing into it. That when I was listening, I was thinking of the Hindi text. Buddhaya, which is a mid-20th century context. It is much later, but it is a book in which the context is mid-20th century. And I was also thinking of a story by Premchand, Mantra. And obviously, we can have discussion around what is political body, how Dalits see themselves and their past, and how even the sympathetic Bharati narrative is not satisfying their own kind of look into the past and these kind of stories. I mean, you said that in their own accounts, if I may say, own accounts, the person enters with the polluted body, and in this sympathetic 19th century text, unless he becomes Brahman, he does not return to India. These are the issues on which we can have a lot of discussions. One can question many assumptions, because at least I can think of one. You will have, obviously you must have addressed this question. But if this agriculture sector is allowing the Dalits in such a big number, and so I'm doing such a big force, how could it be possible that these people could live like that and continue the suffering? One, in the Northern Indian context, we have a slightly different kind of social composition in which the middle class come into the play, who are not actually suffering that much. The suffering of the Dalits is much more than the middle classes. And there comes a situation when it is called upper caste and the middle caste, they come together for the exploitation or the suffering of the Dalits are concerned. These things do happen. This is one thing which came to my mind. I'm sure that many of you would be interested in hoping, entering into a kind of discussion with you, raising some questions. And again, if I get time, I'll have something to comment on. I cannot see whether somebody who is online has a question or not. If you have any question, I think you should go. That is not for you. I cannot read that. So if somebody is interested, then he has to, he or she has to.
It's the chat it. Because of that.
Professor, yes, Professor Patel.
Yes, please go ahead.
Professor Patel, I have asked two questions in the chat box.
I'll read it out.
Please read out my questions.
Would you enlighten us the significance of four background chapters as pointed out? Why didn't you follow the advice of Professor Hada to read text only as text? Vagera, vagera. Okay. Second, in view of suggestion of your Dalit friends that you should make realize your Brahmin and caste Hindu fellows about their attitudes, how far have you succeeded in doing so? That you have to tell me. My question is also because this in India, we have not found any academic who has totally got rid of caste biases. Even in your presentation, I witness only the humiliating sketch of not his anguish in the name of truth. A little bit similar to that of Munshi Premchand. Okay. Okay. Let me see the background chapters. Actually, that was the project I had suggested. That I wanted to situate the work of Gopal Krishna Bharati in the social and literary and theological cultures in which he was embedded. So one embedding which is very central is the Chidambaram temple itself. My first chapter is on the social history of Chidambaram temple in which this whole drama is being enacted. So I think I cannot really understand this whole cult of Nataraja, the cult of Chidambaram, the 3,000 Brahmins who dominate Chidambaram, and the landlordism around it without going into the history of the temple. That is one. Second backgrounding which I wanted to do was on literary culture. The kind of literature, the transformation of Tamil literature from I'm not going into the classical period, but between the early modern period. Why does it become a popular literature? The kind of language used, the kind of poetic forms that are used, these are transformed in the late medieval or what we call now the early modern period. And Gopal Krishna Bharati is not relating to the classical Tamil literature, but he is inheriting a early modern literature and he is situated in that literary culture. So the second context that I wanted to work out was the transformation of early modern literary culture and how Gopal Krishna Bharati fits into that, what he draws, because the several debates happening in Tamil literature, particularly relating to use of language. What is the correct Tamil? What is the correct way of speaking Tamil? And how can written Tamil relate to the folk or spoken language? That's one major debate. There are several other debates. Multilingualism is a matter of debate. These are all happening in the early modern context, and I wanted to situate that. And related to this is the transformation of music and performative arts, because this is a very central performative art that is doing. And in the early modern period, there is a major change in the performative tradition where the role of Dalits as the audience for that performative performances become very important. And therefore, the need to address Dalits and to cater to their requirements and their emotions become very important in the new literature that's emerging. So that's another thing which I wanted to situate.
Can I come in here? Because we may be a different question, I think.
Oh, that's what you're saying. What are the four background chapters and why is it important?
That is one thing. And the other part, which is very important, if I may,
correctly,
he is reminding you of the advice given by somebody that you have to show the mirror to the Brahmins.
That's the second
problem. Yeah, and that is really important. He is saying that he does not come across anybody who is free from caste bias. And he read out the second part of it, and then that can be a useful discussion.
In view of the suggestion of your Dalitran that you should realize your Brahmins and caste Hindu fellows, about their attitudes, how far have you succeeded? My question is because we do not find academics who are free of caste prejudice. Even in your presentation, you have witnessed only the humiliating sketch of Dalit, not his anguish, in the name of the truth, a little bit similar to that of Munshi Premchand. What I am trying to show is what Gopal Krishna Bharati has represented. So I don't have access to what Dalits felt in 19th century. I am trying to say, in Gopal Krishna Bharati's representation, how is the anguish of the Dalit visualized by a Brahmin? Okay, so this is a complicated number of mirrors, looking at it through number of mirrors. Here is a 19th century Brahmin who thinks that caste system is justified, who believes in it, who is looking at Dalits, who experiences in some way the pain and anguish and the protest. So he's combining that in his representation. So I'm trying to see how he's Gopal Krishna Bharati representing the anguish and to what extent. And there is quite a lot of anguish expressed here, and I didn't want to go into it because of the language problem, because most of it will be fall flat if I translate it in English. And in my text, I've tried to give the English and the Tamil text together. I mean, if you want to look at the entire text, I can show it to you later. Whatever anguish points that have been expressed by Gopal Krishna Bharati is there. I try to represent that. What does it mean to upper caste Brahmin reader today? I don't know. So only when I complete the work can I say where have I taken it. Sorry, I cannot answer that question.
May I ask, Sir Patel, two small questions, please? Hello.
Hello.
Yes. Please go ahead.
Yes. So, Subramaniam ji, thank you for bringing Gopala Bharati to us. I have very short questions. One is related to the literary aspect and another is related to the thematic aspect. So the about the literary aspect, could you please tell me that did Gopala Krishna Bharati write in other texts in bhakti mode? Because the compositions generally, you know, this whole medieval bhakti movement, it was basically, you know, the poetry and the musical compositions. And here we find a very elaborate work, which is, of course, as you said, it's a verse drama. So the music aspect is there. But did he write in like other, bhakti movement, general thing was poetry and song? This is one question. The second question is about the subject itself, like Brahmin trying to understand the anguish of the Dalits. Now, my point is, was Gopala Krishna Bharati writing as a bhakta himself?
Yeah
this is so please.
I think that is both these are important. See, Gopala Krishna Bharati is known mainly as a music composer and lyric composer. So we have a large body of his lyrics apart from what he wrote in this text. Okay. So even today, a lot of these lyrics are sung by most of the musicians. So he composed bhakti based, like Tyagaraja or Muthuswami Dikshitar. He is basically what is called part of the Tamil Trinity. Muthuswami Dikshitar, other called the classical Trinity, because they compose not in Tamil, but either in Sanskrit or in Telugu. Gopala Krishna Bharati composed in Tamil and he was part of another Trinity of Tamil composers. And he was mainly composing in honor of Chidambaram Natarajan. So most of his compositions are, and he was a great bhakta himself. I mean, he was more a bhakta than a musician or a literary person, because those who were in classical Tamil literature didn't recognize his literature at all. They said, ki, ye to bhakti wale hai. So that kind of a distancing is there. Second point that, your question was whether he was writing as a bhakta. It is a bhakti text. Okay. And he is writing as a bhakta. And the point of view that he is giving is what I will call a conformist bhakta, who sees that there is a tension between the social reality and bhakti. But he still thinks it can be resolved within the framework of bhakti. That is the point that he is trying to make, and I think that is the tension which he is unable to get out of.
Yes. पारंपरिक पद्धति समय के परिप्रेक्ष्य में किसी रचना का या इसके मैं ये देखता कि वो समय उस रचना का रचना में इस तरह अच्छा शुरू में आपने भी देखा मेरे पर ये पद्धति दुनिया के तौर पर रचना भी एक अन्वेषण हम एक समय और समाज में एक और विचलित करने वाली बात नहीं हुई यह हम अब आइडेंटिटी डिस्कोर्स में ही कार्य का पूरे भक्ति का आयोजन तभी किसी भक्ति को दलित दलित संत बल्कि हुआ ये कि कई बार जैसे ही आपने भक्त होने की या संत होने की अहंता अर्जित की आप मुझे लगता है कि वर्ण और जाति से अलग काम ऊपर ऐसा बहुत बार सभी के साथ मुझे स्मरण नहीं है कि किसी भक्ति या संत को पूरे भक्ति मूवमेंट में किसी दूसरे ने अलबत्त उसने जरूर कहा होगा एक और बात जो जातियों के पास आज भी यदि आप उत्तर भारत में मुझे पता नहीं क्या लेकिन मैं उत्तर भारत की बात नहीं जानता दलित जातियों के लोग रूस बहुत बड़ी और उनकी काश्त उनकी जमीन उस पर उनको कभी बेदखल नहीं किया गया उस काश्त से भक्ति काल से बहुत पहले से ही परंपरा चलती इस तरह व्यवहार अच्छा गुजर उसको उत्तर भारत का दर्शन उत्तर भारत में ब्राह्मण रूस स्वामी की रास्ते मतलब स्वामी और लॉर्ड में यदि आराम करते हैं तो देखने को भी मेरा बता रहा था कि थोड़ा मुश्किल विषय होना होगा उस स्वामी मालिक तो वो है लेकिन उसको उदक या धर्मार्थ दी गई भूमि है जिस पर उसका मौसी हक है खास बात और ये केवल अधिकांश उत्तर भारतीय ब्राह्मण कर्मकांड करते हैं या ब्राह्मण कोई ऐसा काम करते हैं काश्तकार एक्चुअली जैसे गांव का दलित काश्तकार है कमोपेश उससे भी खराब हैसियत है एक और बात जो बार बार आपने कही है
भारत में किसी रास्ता जैसी स्थिति कभी आई थी उत्पादन पर कभी भी कोई बाहरी नियंत्रण भारतीय कृषक के उत्पादन पर कभी कोई बाहरी नियंत्रण वो स्वतंत्र था अपने उत्पादन के नाम ये अलग है कि 140 या 130 उसको देना है राजस्व के लिए और वो परंपरा बहुत 16 14 15 हमेशा से चली आ रही है व्यवस्था है मुझे लगता है मैं थोड़ा मुझे लगता है कुछ चीजों पर नए सिरे से सोचा जा सकता है बाकी मुझे बहुत अच्छा एक रचना का जैसे ओपेरा मुझे लगता है कि ये जो हमारी अपनी
ओपेरा गलत शब्द है मगर और कोई बेहतर शब्द
बस अनुवाद में शायद ये बेहतर शब्द नहीं रहा होगा लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि ये जो रूप है जिस रूप की आप चर्चा कर रहे हैं कि कुछ गाएगा कुछ नरेट करेगा और कुछ अभिनय करेगा
जी।
ये हमारा अपना एक जातीय कथा रूप
है
और ये भारत के विभिन्न भागों में अलग अलग तरह से प्रचलन में है मुझे लगता है कि इसके लिए ओपेरा जैसा शब्द
अच्छा नहीं है
ठीक नहीं धन्यवाद
बहुत बढ़िया और बहुत आपके काम किया है क्योंकि ये सवाल आएंगे आपके पास आई थिंक वी कैन गैदर क्वेश्चंस एंड कमेंट्स एंड एट द एंड यू विल बी इन अ पोजीशन टू रिस्पॉन्ड इफ यू फाइंड नेसेसरी बिकॉज वी कैन नॉट गो मच बियॉन्ड फाइव नॉर्मली क्लोज बाय फाइव बट वी हैव ओनली फाइव मिनट्स आई वुड टेक टू मिनट्स फॉर माइसेल्फ एंड देन I mean, you can go up to 5-7 minutes more, maybe 5 past 5, 10 past 5, not beyond that. Or koi kisi ko kuch karna hai.
Kisi ko kuch karna hai. Please. Sir, bahut, tum ke bahut sari chize nahi tarike se pata chale. एक तो ये जो नाम पर्याय के लिए ढेर सारे आपने बताया कि इस तरह के नाम रखे जाते थे मुझे उससे एक बात ध्यान हुआ है कि भारतेंदु हरिश्चंद हिंदी में एक बहुत फेमस आदमी है और उनके किसी निबंध में ये एक पंक्ति थी जो हम लोग मास्टर से पढ़ते थे कि भारत के 90% लोगों के नाम में राम लगा हुआ है तो कैसे कोई कहता है कि राम को अलग करके देखें तो उस पर्चा लिखते हुए मैं ये पढ़या और ये सब नहीं इतनी चीजें नहीं सोची मैंने लेकिन मैंने अंतिमली ये लिख दिया कि शायद वो गांव में नहीं गए और मैंने ऐसे 20 नाम लिखे उस पर्चे में जिसमें जो कि दलित जातियों के लोगों के होते हैं फुंसी को फलनवा ढंकन है और बाद में वो पर्चा लीक हो गया वहां से और पूरे यूनिवर्सिटी में चर्चा होने लगी कि इन्होंने 20 नाम गिना दिए हैं कि जो राम नहीं फेंकू राम हो गया मैं एक चीज सर थोड़ा जानना चाह रहा था कि जो स्लेव होते थे ये नेसेसरली दलित होते थे जो अच्छा ये जानना चाह रहा था और दूसरा ये कि हाँ ये जो बात आपने कही कि वहाँ तीन ही कला के कैटेगरी मुख्य तौर पर देखने को मिलता है ब्राह्मण लालाजी सूत्र तो वो ऐसा क्यों वहाँ इस कला की कैटेगरी जारी क्यों क्षत्रिय और एक बात आखिरी में जो कहना है मुझे वो ये कि हमारे यहाँ भी ऐसे हुए हैं भक्ति काल में कभी खासतौर से दो कवि कबीर और रास जिनके लिए जिनकी जो बहुत विद्वान थे तो ये भी अपमानजनक है कि उन्हें कहा गया कि रास के लिए लिखा गया है कि वो पूर्व जन्म में ब्राह्मण थे कुछ गलत काम कर लिए तो सूत्र घर में पैदा हो गए ज्ञान इसलिए था क्योंकि पूर्व जन्म ब्राह्मण और ये मोनोग्राफ साहित्य पृथ्वी का उसमें लिखा हुआ है और
शरीर अंदर से निकाल
हाँ तो वो हाँ अंदर से निकाली और कबीर को कहा गया कि वो विधवा ब्राह्मणी के बेटे हैं तो ये इस तरह का जो ये है जो आप कह रहे थे ना कि इंसल्ट किया जाता है, ये भी एक इंसल्ट है कि जैसे ही आप कुछ पढ़े लिखे हो गए, तो विद्वान हो गए, समझदार हो गए, तो लोग कहेंगे कि गांव में सामान्य तौर पर लोग कहते हैं लगता है कि उस गांव वाले का खून आ गया है इसके लिए। ये जो तंज है ना, ये भले ही अब मैं तो हैरान हूँ ये सुन के, यूपी और बिहार दो जगह की राजनीति और समाज के नजदीक से मैंने देखा, किसी भी दलित परिवार के पास 10 बीघे जमीन तो नहीं है, लैंड होल्डिंग है नहीं, किसी हमारे मेरे पूरे जिले में लैंड होल्डिंग दलितों के पास नहीं है। वो काम करते हैं सवर्ण जातियों के खेतों पर, या फिर जो ओबीसी जातियां काठीपुर की पिछड़ जातियां हैं उनके खेतों पर काम करते हैं, लैंड होल्डिंग है ही नहीं है उनके पास। और इसीलिए इतना प्रोमिनेंट तरीके से बिहार में हर बार इलेक्शन था, मुद्दा होता है कि लैंड डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन किया जाएगा, लैंड रिफॉर्म किया जाएगा, ये धोखा कैसे खड़ा किया जा सकता है कि उनके पास बड़ी जमीन है, फिर ब्राह्मीण पास भी जमीने हैं, छत्ती के पास भी जमीने हैं, यादव के पास भी जमीने, फुद्दू पास इतनी जमीन है कहाँ भाई, इतनी जमीनों की बात की जा रही है। मेरा ये गोपाल कृष्ण भारती के लिए बात मेरे मन में है कि क्या गोपाल कृष्ण भारती जैसे कवि ने लिखा है जाति के खिलाफ, तो आपने कहा गोपाल कृष्ण भारती चिदम्बरम मंदिर में बात थे, क्या उन्होंने जो और चीजें लिखी हैं क्या उनमें वो जाति का विरोध या वर्ण का विरोध इस तरह की चीजें हैं, वो मैं जानना चाहता हूँ।
You can stop there and I can make a few responses and देखिए, एक जो मेरा एजेंडा है इसमें एक साहित्य और आध्यात्मिक जो पक्ष है उस पर आराम से 2 अलग चैप्टर्स में सोचूं कि उन्होंने क्या, साहित्यिक नहीं है, इट्स साहित्यिक कम म्यूजिकल फ्रॉम जो भी है परफॉर्मेटिव, इसमें उन्होंने क्या तरीके अपनाए अपनी बात कहने के लिए, और उसका विवेचना मैं एक करना चाहता हूँ। दैट इज वन एजेंडा विच आई हैव, बट हियर आई एम ट्राइंग टू सी हाउ इज ही रिप्रेजेंटिंग हिज मीन, वाई इज ही डूइंग इट। सी, वो ये कर सकते थे कि वो नंदनार के बारे में लिखना था, नंदनार के बारे में लिख दिया खत्म, बट वाई डिड ही क्रिएट दट होल टाइपोलॉजी ऑफ अ दलित एग्रीकल्चरल स्लेव? इट वॉज नॉट नेसेसरी फॉर द स्टोरी एट ऑल, दिस इज हिज ओन क्रिएशन। वाई डिड ही डू इट? बिकॉज इट हैड स्टक हिम अदर एज अ प्रॉब्लम, ही वॉन्टेड टू पोज इट एज अ प्रॉब्लम एंड इन पोजिंग दैट प्रॉब्लम ही यूज दिस मेथड। सो दिस एंड वॉट डिड ही रिप्रेजेंट, दैट इज वॉट आई एम ट्राइंग टू लुक एट इन दिस चैप्टर। About landlordism, I'm not very sure. It is true that all over India we have underplayed the fact that Dalits own land. We have even underplayed the fact that Dalits engaged in agriculture. ये राम नारायण रावत करके एक हिस्टोरियन है जिन्होंने यूपी के चमारों पे खास काम किया, एंड ही मेक्स इट वेरी क्लियर दैट चमार्स वर एक्चुअली इन ब्रिटिश रिकॉर्ड, अर्ली ब्रिटिश रिकॉर्ड इज वेरी क्लियर दैट चमार्स ओन्ड एक्सटेंसिव लैंड, जमींदारियां भी थी। छत्तीसगढ़ में अगर आप जाएंगे तो सतनामी जो संप्रदाय के लोग हैं जो मुख्य रूप से दलित जाति के हैं, दे होल्ड जमींदारी। सो इट्स नॉट दैट दे आर टोटली लैंडलेस और टोटली पावरलेस काइंड ऑफ थिंग, सो दैट वी नीड टू रिवर्क दिस बिकॉज दैट देर इज अ व्हाट आई विल कॉल, देर इज अ पर्टिकुलर इमेजिनेशन ऑफ व्हाट अ दलित इज, वी नीड टू ब्रेक दैट, दैट इज अ नीड फॉर। बट फिर भी आप जो कह रहे हैं वो सही है कि दलित बाय एंड लार्ज रिमेन लैंडलेस एग्रीकल्चर, दैट्स अ फैक्ट। सर, आपने जो कहा प्रेजेंट प्रोडक्शन के बारे में, हरवंश मुखिया के बारे में, संभवतः ये नॉर्थ इंडिया के अधिकांश इलाकों पर सही है, डेक्कन में भी सही है, साउथ इंडिया में भी काफी इलाके हैं जो जिसको हम प्रेजेंट प्रोडक्शन इलाके कहते हैं। बट जिस पर्टिकुलर इलाके की हम बात करें जो कोस्टल इरिगेटेड एग्रीकल्चर बेल्ट है, वहां पर इसको प्रेजेंट प्रोडक्शन कहना बहुत ही प्रॉब्लमेटिक है। देर इज लैंडलॉर्डिज्म एंड देर इज लैंड एग्रीकल्चरल, एक पॉपुलेशन में देखेंगे तो लगभग 20-25% पॉपुलेशन में लगभग 30% तक जाते हैं। मीन ये एक डिस्ट्रिक्ट के अंदर अगर आप देखेंगे तो ये पॉकेट्स हैं इंटेंसिव एग्रीकल्चर के जहाँ 30% दलित एग्रीकल्चरल वर्कर्स। तो यू कैन नॉट एक्सप्लेन इट बाय सेइंग दैट देवर पीक, जो इरफान हबीब या मुखिया साहब कहते हैं कि पीक एग्रीकल्चरल सीजन में जो लेबर की जरूरत है, इसलिए कुछ दलितों को एग्रीकल्चर में एंगेज करते हैं, जिसका मतलब है भाई पूरे गांव में 5-10 लोग होंगे तो बहुत बड़ी बात है। बट अगर आप राजस्थान के ही सोर्सेस देखेंगे, कई गांव ऐसे हैं जिसमें बहुत ज्यादा सडनली आपको दलित दिखते, क्यों इतने दलित हैं वहां उस गांव में? सो ऑब्वियसली देयर इज समथिंग मोर टू इट देन क्राफ्ट और एक्स्ट्रा एग्रीकल्चर। देर इज समी नीड टू लुक एट इट मोर केयरफुली। साउथ इंडिया देर इज अ डिफरेंट, देर आर लार्ज पॉकेट्स कोरामंडल कोस्ट एंड इन द केरला कोस्ट यू हैव अ स्ट्रॉन्ग प्रेजेंस ऑफ अग्रेस्टिक स्लेवरी। देर इज एक्टिव स्लेव मार्केट राइट टिल 1860s। खरीद फरोख्त होता था, नीलामी होती। ये बहुत स्पष्ट है 19वीं शताब्दी में, और ये बाद में बंद हो जाता है। सो एग्रेस्टिक स्लेवरी पे काफी लिखा गया है, बुकनन हैमिल्टन के टाइम से इसके बारे में रिपोर्ट्स हैं, कलेक्टर्स के रिपोर्ट्स हैं, काफी इसमें डिटेल्स में। सारे देश में बिल्कुल सही, मैं तो उस पर्टिकुलर इलाके की बात कर रहा हूँ, लेकिन वो काफी महत्वपूर्ण। एग्रेस्टिक स्लेवरी इन साउथ इंडिया के बारे में काफी किताबें भी हैं इस पे, शारदा मुनि करके एक है, धर्मा कुमार ने भी इसके बारे में काफी लिखा है। बट इट इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट बिकॉज दिस वॉज द हैपनिंग प्लेस कल्चरली। तंजावुर डिस्ट्रिक्ट इज द हब ऑफ तमिल कल्चर, एंड यू लुक एट द वेस्ट कोस्ट, इट इज द हब ऑफ द केरला कल्चर। सो दिस हब्स ऑफ cultures are based on slave production. You cannot dismiss it. वो काफी important है culturally, वो उस structure में important role है, उसको हम dismiss नहीं कर सकते। महाराष्ट्र तक ये देखा गया 19वीं सेंचुरी में, महाराष्ट्र तक aggressive slavery की prominence थी। महाराष्ट्र में महार कितने agricultural काम करते थे ये अभी तक मैंने वर्कआउट नहीं किया, क्योंकि बाहरों की दूसरे तरह के काम के बारे में ज्यादा कहा जाता है। ओके दैट इज इट। अच्छा, नाम के बारे में एक चीज मैं कहना चाहता हूँ। देखिए, मैं आपसे कहूंगा कि आज से आप स्कूल में चले जाइए, स्कूल में अटेंडेंस रजिस्टर्स होंगे, अटेंडेंस रजिस्टर निकाल के आप देख लीजिए आज से 10 साल पहले के नाम के पैटर्न। ये जो पौराणिक नाम का जो एंट्री है स्कूल रजिस्टर्स में, इसको एक्चुअली अपडेट कर सकते हैं। कौन से समाज के लोग पौराणिक लोगों के नाम रख रहे हैं, कौन से समाज के लोग गैर पौराणिक नाम रख रहे हैं, इसके बहुत क्लियर पैटर्न्स आपको स्कूल रजिस्टर में आप निकाल के देख लीजिए। आमतौर पे स्कूल्स में 1930s से मिल जाएंगे, 1950s से भी मिल जाएंगे। मैंने खूब देखे हैं स्कूल रजिस्टर्स, तो मैं कह सकता हूँ there is a very distinct shift in the last 10 20 years in the name of times। 30 may be too much, maine to zyada 30 year wale nahi dekhe।
जो
स्पीकर ऑन किया है ना आपने? वो ब्राह्मणों में भी होता है।
नहीं वो तो है सर, लेकिन तुलसी नहीं होगा, घुरा नहीं होगा।
यस,
तुलसी घुरा नहीं होगा।
अच्छा, एक
हमें कुछ चीजें स्वीकार करनी चाहिए।
कमेंट था
ये एक बहुत सारी चीजें हैं, जैसे बेचन
एक टिप्पणी की थी भक्ति आंदोलन और आइडेंटिटी को लेकर। इस पे मैं एक चीज कहना चाहता हूँ, ये एक्चुअली बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग है कि अगर मैं पेरिय पुराणम लेता हूँ, जो बेसिकली वन ऑफ द अर्लीस्ट हैजियोग्राफीज हैं जो भक्तों के जीवन चरित्र में, उसमें कोशिश की गई है कि हर भक्त के जातीय पहचान को बताने की और उनके जातीय काम और उन जातीय हैसियत को बताने का हैसियत वहाँ बहुत क्लियर है। मेरे ख्याल से भक्तमाल वगैरह में भी ये नहीं है क्या? अच्छा, जैसे अब मैं अगर मराठी लिटरेचर में जाऊं, चोखा मेला के बारे में कि वो दलित है, महार है, ये तो हर तुकाराम कहते हैं और वो एकनाथ कहते हैं और चोखा मेला तो कुछ कहते ही हैं, पर पर बाकी लोग भी कहते हैं कि वे महार होते हुए ये भक्त बना, और महार होने के कारण उसको मंदिर के अंदर लोगों ने, पंडितों ने प्रवेश नहीं दिया, और पंडरी जो पांडुरंग ने उनको अंदर ले गया, ये बातें दूसरे भक्त कहते हैं। क्या अर्हता मिली? मंदिर में प्रवेश करने की अर्हता चोखा मेला को नहीं मिली।
I think this is another issue on which we can go on discussing. I will take 2 minutes because I also felt like saying something when these questions, interesting questions were being raised. First of all, I was thinking of the difficulties with an academic like Subramanian. He is trying to be as open as possible and trying to accommodate all kinds of things into his work. And still, this comes as a surprise in a way, and in fact, it is very painful and very important also that the Subramanian can go up to Premchand. He can not understand the anguish. He can only talk about the humiliation. This was said. And I think this is a very important observation. How to create a kind of academic space in which these kind of agencies could not be allocated to the groups and in these kind of binaries. And I think this is a question, this is my own take on it could be, that we need to be little more open. Because as it turned out to be, there is a need to go research on these things, bring in a lot of information and new research into it to understand whether there was a real kind of demarcation between what is called upper caste and Dalit in different parts of India or not. Even without doing that research, we are taking positions. And that is why there is becoming a kind of separation of spaces. Therefore, we are becoming ideological and bringing these ideological positions into all kind of and therefore, you begin listening a presentation, and you start taking a position. And I'm saying this in a very straightforward manner, because I have found that one kind of fluidity, one kind of openness, one kind of eagerness to go beyond what we really think about is needed. You hardly know much about South Indian history. And on the basis of what constitutes an identity, we always try to jump to a conclusion. And that is a very dangerous thing. And I think Subramanian ji is doing one work in which he is opening up spaces. And that is why I think his presentation is a very challenging one. And it is going to be a very interesting one. Last but not the least, I found it very, very important for me. And I learned many things. Because you see, when you deal with literature and not a historical source per se, you have many temptations. You can use it this way or you can use that way. And in this situation, as I'm also working on using literature as a source for understanding of past, I find that we need to be a little more, open is a word I'm using more often, because this is what I believe one has to move towards. Somebody is writing in 19th century and he is presenting a text, a story of 12th century. How much time, how much he can bring the contemporary time into that text is a good thing. I mean, it can be seen. But also it has to be seen how that person as a creative artist is refiguring or configuring the entire text in order to say something to his chosen audience, which is in this case Brahmins themselves. This is what we are trying to say, that he is also addressing the Brahmins of his time. In that context, his artistic endeavors need to be seen from his creative standpoint. And that is why writers like Anantamurthy, Sanskar becomes such a very complex text. Because you see, you tend to go into a kind of debate where you can talk about traditions as well as modernities. Not tradition and modernity. And therefore, we need to be, I am very impressed by, I mean, we all are, by this kind of work. As women, he is taking up a huge responsibility of making things understandable to us in a way in which we can be more open as conditions. I'm really excited and I'm really looking forward to the completion of this work. And I'm really grateful to him for giving me the honor of chairing this session. Thank you very much.
The honor is mine. Thank you.
What will happen to me? Next week.
Very well.
Sir.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
Lots of cooking and breakfast between the room.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
End meeting kar rahe hai na.